Yeah, so I'll start and then pass it to you. Is it okay if I call you a researcher from the...
Yeah, that's great. I'm having like a little bit of a delay. It might be my computer, so hopefully all is fine on my end, but shouldn't affect anything. Okay.
All right, thank you for your patience, everybody. We're going to get started here. So I will hand it over to our lovely ladies to discuss how to be an anti-racist safety hero.
Thank you so much, Carrie, and hi, everyone. I know we can't see you, but we're super, super excited to have you here today. As Carrie shared, our presentation today is from is called How to Be an Anti-Racist Safety Hero, and we'll introduce ourselves. So my name is Ariam. I'm a public engagement consultant with the City of Calgary, and I have Jasmine here, who's from Habitus Consulting Collective, who's a researcher from the team that we hired to support us in our anti-racism work. This is us here just smiling along, but Jasmine, go ahead and say hi.
Hi everyone, nice to meet you.
What's really exciting about why we're here today is that a lot of this work is really getting a lot of energy lately, and really after the Black Lives Matter movements that started in 2020, we all started really talking about how the city can play more of a role in supporting our relationships and addressing racism here in our lives in Calgary. So in 2020, as a response to the Black Lives Matter movement, the City of Calgary actually hosted a series of consultations with the public to listen about people's experiences around racism. And from there, we actually then created an anti-racism action plan that led to us hiring two different groups of consultants, so different teams. So Jasmine's part of Habitus Consulting, and then I, and then Action Dignity is the other team that's also been supporting this work. And from there, we actually even then created the anti-racism program team, which is overseeing all this work within the City of Calgary, and I'm part of that team. But once we got the consultants in and then Jasmine's team in, we actually started doing some more concentrated work with the community, and I'll let Jasmine share a bit about that.
Sure. Thanks, Ariam. So from September to December last year, so my team at Habitus and then the Action Dignity team, we hosted some big events and smaller events where we listened and learned from a diverse group of Calgarians about what the city can do to be anti-racist. So this included hearing the perspectives of young people such as yourselves about their experiences in Calgary. So today we're going to take you through a journey of what it means to be an anti-racist safety hero. So by talking about three different pillars of safety: neighborhood life, public safety, and social well-being. So before we get started, I'm going to ask everyone a question, and you'll be able to answer on a link, I believe, in the chat. So it's our first question we're going to ask, and it's, is racism an important safety issue?
So the next slide, I think that we'll have a poll that everybody can answer. Are we able to move to the next slide? Sorry, Carrie.
Maybe it's frozen. And then I think once you have the link, Carrie will just read out the response. Perfect. There's the question. And I think we can give everyone maybe about 30 seconds or so to answer the question.
Hey folks, sorry about that. We're having some fun with the technology. Yes, so apologies folks. Thank you for your patience. And we've got the link right here. So if everybody wants to click on that and submit your answers, I can read out what the responses are.
We're hoping to make sure or we check in with everybody in today. So we'll have a few of these different poll questions, but to start us off, we want to ask you first if you thought if racism is an important safety issue. So look at those responses, use that link that Carrie's sending to you.
Okay. So we have some coming in. I'm just going to give folks a little bit more time. Yeah. We have 6 responses at the moment. So give them another 5 seconds. Okay, so we have 13 responses and everybody agreed for question.
Everyone said yes, that racism is a safety issue.
Question 1.
Perfect.
We have yes all across the board.
Okay, wonderful. Hey, thanks everyone for answering those questions.
Everybody agrees it's an important safety issue.
Yeah, and you're right, it definitely is, and we'll get more into that. But first, I just want to go over a comfort agreement, which is just on the next slide. So okay, while that's queuing up, I'll just say we want to start off with something that is important, and that's our comfort agreement with everyone here. So
yes, being comfortable. 100%.
So being comfortable in these conversations is really important. Our agreement with you is that if this conversation is too difficult, you can step away and we're okay with that. And we ask for your agreement with us that you're respectful and kind to everyone here. So as we know, talking about racism can be really difficult. So if you feel uncomfortable or if you don't want to take part, that's okay. We also encourage you to talk with someone that you know and trust. If you have feelings that that are brought up from this conversation, from what you hear today. So with that, we're gonna watch a short video about what racism is. So yeah, it's just about 5 minutes and it's kind of a good overview about the topic.
Perfect. Yeah, and so we'll get into the video on the next slide and be able to hear from some different youth around your age, actually, that about their experiences, really. It looks like the sound isn't working. We just want to make sure. If you put it, make sure to start presented with sound.
Oh, apologies, folks. Here, 1 second.
I'm from Haiti and Nigeria.
So I think the sound is just still muted. So sorry, everyone. I know technology is a lot of fun for us.
I'm from Haiti and Nigeria. And I was sharing the food that we ate. And then I got made fun of them. They're like, what is that?
So I'll just share my screen. I think it's causing some feedback. So let me share. I'll include the sound. So, oops. So I can make this large, start from the beginning, and let me know if you can hear the sound.
I'm from Haiti and Nigeria. Like three things, like I'm Dominican, Puerto Rican, and Black. I'm biracial. I have an African-American father and an Irish-American mom.
My name's Lameen. I'm Muslim.
I'm Indian, British, Scottish, and American.
My parents are from Venezuela, and I was sharing like one of the foods that we eat, and then I got made fun of. They were like, what is that? Ew. Oh, ew, what is that? And like I cried because I felt like, oh, there's something wrong where I'm from. Like maybe like it's bad, like I'm different.
I am an African-American adopted girl, only child, and I live with my two dads.
I remember when I was younger, I went with my family to a restaurant, and they made us pay in advance just in case we like didn't pay afterwards, and that was kind of upsetting.
You start to notice that people are different and you have comments, they might be racist or they might not be, but by the time you get older, you know that it is racist and you should stop.
I feel a little scared about if I, you know, just walk down the street, you know, cops might just think I'm doing something bad, and then if I'm trying to explain to them, they won't listen and then just start beating me up and doing terrible things to me.
I think there's like this anxiety that kind of comes with being biracial, like that kind of eats away at you, like almost like you have to prove yourself like that you're one or the other. Like for example, like I hear the phrase you're not Black all the time.
People sometimes think that I'm supposed to like talk ghetto or like whatever that is.
Oh, she's uneducated because she's African-American.
Because I'm Hispanic or Latino, I can't have like a lot of money.
Just this weekend, I went with my friend to Urban Outfitters and we were shopping and I really wanted to try on this dress. And then this lady that was just like there, she was kind of like watching me and I'm just like, I'm not gonna steal it or anything.
I think white privilege is the idea that in your everyday life, you're getting treated differently and sometimes with more respect, or people just trust you more, or they have certain expectations of you, like you might be smarter or you might be wealthier because you're white. It makes me feel guilty sometimes, even though it's not my fault. Like, I feel guilty for having a privilege that, like, I don't deserve.
If I was ever, like, the mayor or something that controls the policemen, I would want to go out and look in the neighborhoods where there are people that's very friendly, so you can pick them instead of, like, these guys that's just doing all this training. It's better to pick people that's more minded with the community than to just pick some new guy and get on the street. Like, it's just not gonna work out.
We have, like, these kids from, they're Ecuadorian, and they get made fun of because they look Mexican. And they get told on a daily basis, oh, you like tacos? Oh, you like churros? You sell, how come I saw your mom on the corner selling ices? Like, it's, like, I feel bad for them personally, because I'm like, wow, like, they're not, and like, even though they tell them I'm not Mexican, I'm Ecuadorian, they still get teased.
Thank you, everyone. That video there is just a great example to hear different perspectives from 12-year-old youth, as the video was called, being 12. And you can hear kind of the impact of having these negative views and thoughts of different races. But racism isn't always just about feeling bad. It can actually really impact your life in many negative ways as well. So they gave some examples of maybe there too. And I know that video was really, really powerful because it really showed their real feelings and how they felt. But racism, as a clear definition on the next slide here, if our presentation come up, is the belief that one racial group is better than the other. And so I'll take a minute just to help us bring that presentation up so we can take a look at it. I think we're just having that leg back forth, but oh, there it is. Yeah. And so I just wanted to share that definition because it's really great and important for us to have words for what we're experiencing, what we're dealing with, and especially with racism, it's really important to know what it actually is. And so because racism lets us believe that one racial group is better than the other, it ends up creating and enforcing unjust and unfair policies, practices, and beliefs. So this usually leads us into society to give it extra advantages to some people, as the one girl shared in the video where she said, I didn't deserve like being privileged. But it also then what happens is also disadvantages others. If you're discriminated against or judged for your race, sometimes it can also make you feel like you don't belong, and it can even be and feel like you're bad, but it also can be dangerous for people who are not part of that group that is considered better, because it can impact their lives, where the judgments made on your skin color can lead to very serious consequences and limit how much you can actually participate and the opportunities and abilities we have in society. So what we're trying to do, and what the whole team is here, and we have these great consultants like Happitus, or Jasmine's been supporting us, is work towards being anti-racist, because we know racism is very real in society, and it is a safety issue, as we all agreed, that our goal is, by being anti-racist, we're taking clear actions just to address it, because not just thinking racism is bad is not good enough to be able to actually start making that change. We need to actually make clear actions. So next slide. We have another fun poll. We're gonna ask you a lot of questions because we're like, how do we get you guys involved and hear what you're thinking or get you to think as well? And so this poll here is asking you, or this question is, which of the following list in the question there can be examples of racism? So it might take a moment. I think Carrie's gonna share the link in the for you to be able to answer the questions, but the options you have for this question is, when people laugh at the food I bring to school for lunch because it made me feel different from everybody else. Or it says, option number two says, people at the restaurant made us pay before we got our food because they thought we wouldn't be able to. The third option is that, like the girl mentioned in the video, staff follow me when I go into stores. And then the last one was option four, which is all of the above. So I think if we have a moment, I know it's going to take a second, but if you want to answer the question, what you think, which ones are examples of racism?
Okay, so We do have some responses. So we have, everybody agreed that all of the above, with the exception there are two folks that chose option number one, that people laugh at the food, and somebody chose people at the restaurant example.
Well, all the answers are actually right. So it was all the above, but even the other two are still examples. That were chosen are some examples of racism. The actions, the behaviors, the way we treat people based on their race or their skin color, it really does actually show examples of racism. And even though those are minor or sometimes can be smaller, maybe not severe outcomes of racism, they're still actions that really are supporting the idea that one group of race or one race is better than the other. And so that's a great, and thank you everyone for participating in those questions. What we want to get into right now then is to those three areas of how we can be an anti-racist safety hero. And I'll pass it back to Jasmine, who'll start on the next slide about neighborhood life.
Great, thanks, Ariam. So now that we've done some introductions about why we're here and what racism is and what it looks like and what anti-racism is as well. So we're going to look at what being an anti-racist safety hero in your neighborhood can look like. So we're first going to talk about neighborhood life. So if we could go to the next slide. Okay, so what does a good life in your neighborhood look like? So I'd like to ask everyone listening to picture in your mind the neighborhood that you live in and ask yourself some questions. So in your neighborhood, can you easily get to everything you want and need to be healthy? Do you have a rec center, a park that you like and feel comfortable going to? Do you have a playground that you like going to? If you need to leave your neighborhood to get anything, is that also easy to do for you and your family? So all of these things are part of neighborhood life. So when we look at what services the city provides in your neighborhood, that might be things like public transit, like buses and trains, maybe certain social programs like community events or summer camps, parks. The city might also provide housing in your neighborhood, recreation centers. So being able to have these things like housing, transit, parks, these are important because it helps make your life stable and is important for your physical and mental health. So knowing that, when we talk about racism, we have to look about, what does this have to do with racism? So when we talk about racism, we have to look at how racism might impact whether life in someone's neighborhood is good or not. So we know, or I think we all agree, that all neighborhoods should be places where everyone has what they need to live a safe, happy, and healthy life. But racism can disadvantage groups of people and even whole neighborhoods that have higher populations of Indigenous, Black, and other racialized people. So because of discrimination and because we still judge people based on race, some neighborhoods end up not having the needed services, programs, and resources for the people living in them. So we're going to look at an example of what this could look like. So if we could go to the next slide, we're going to talk a little bit about Hala's story. So meet Hala. Hala is 11 years old and she's a newcomer to Canada. She really wants to join an after-school program that she heard her friends talking about in class, where she could play sports and do fun activities, and it sounded like a lot of fun, so she really wanted to join. However, Hala doesn't think she'll be able to go, so while her parents both have an education and meaningful jobs in their home countries, when they came to Canada, they were told they don't have enough Canadian experience, and are working multiple cleaning jobs to support Hala's family. So because these jobs run late into the evening, Hala's parents don't have time to drive her anywhere when she finishes school. So also, Hala's family got affordable housing in the east part of Calgary, but the recreation center where the after-school program is not close to her house at all. She could take the bus, but the last bus comes back home way after dark. So Hala and her family don't think that this is a safe option for her. So, and there's actually no other programs anywhere close by her house where Hala can join in. So we just want to explain that Calgary has a lot of newcomer families just like Hala's. And I'm just going to go over a few points of what Hala's story can tell us about racism. So we know that a lot of new immigrants, despite job experience that they might have, are working in jobs that are lower paying and work hours into the evening. And this can make it harder for their kids to be supported during after school hours. Also, sometimes affordable housing isn't close to recreational centers or parks. So kids have to take buses a long ways just to get to certain facilities and have access to certain programs. We also know that in Calgary, actually over time, neighborhoods with more immigrants, and usually immigrants who are visible minorities, have received less support and resources than other neighborhoods in Calgary. So what this might look like is less public art, less parks, less recreation centers, even things maybe like sidewalks and less transit options and social programs. So Paula's story definitely tells us a lot about different people's experiences in Calgary. So if we could go to the next slide. So knowing that racism can impact your neighborhood, what it looks like, what you have access to or not, so how can you be an anti-racist safety hero in your neighborhood? So the first step of being anti-racist is recognizing it when you see it. So racism isn't always seen as something that impacts our lives. So the first thing you can do is name it and be aware. So part of that, it's good to take a look around you when you're with your family and friends in your neighborhood. Ask them what they think about where they live. Ask them if there's something in their neighborhood that, you know, it might make it better, a better place to live. Sometimes making a change is naming something that is wrong and being aware of what's around us and asking questions. So the second way you can be an anti-racist safety hero in your neighborhood is to raise your voice and to get involved. So in racism, like many other aspects of life, it's important to both be aware and act on your awareness as well. So when you notice things that are wrong in your neighborhood, this could be anything like roads that might need repairing. Maybe there's a crosswalk that needs to go over a busy road. Maybe like your local park needs some cleaning up. So you can do things like talking with your family and friends, volunteering for different youth opportunities in your neighborhood, your community association, at your school, or the City of Calgary, for example, the Mayor's Youth Council, which you could join when you're a little older. And even just being a good neighbor. So that could look like sharing information, sharing resources to people who might be new or isolated. You could be a good classmate at school. Maybe you notice that someone needs help with something. And you can always make the extra effort to make others feel welcome and included, regardless of anyone's background. So those are some options to be an anti-racist safety hero in your neighborhood. And so when you notice problems and you speak up about them, that's how you can really make a difference where you live. So with that, I'm going to pass things over to Ariam, who's going to talk about the next section on social well-being.
Yeah, thank you, Jasmine. And so the next section about how you can be an anti-racist safety hero is looking at our social well-being. And so social well-being is knowing or is how well or good you feel in your community and even just to the wider society, like here in the City of Calgary. And so on the next slide, we want to share a few examples. So there's things that can help you with your social well-being and make your social well-being better. So that's about feeling good in where you live, feeling welcome in your neighborhood and city, and feeling like you can fully participate in society. So take part in all the different things that our city, like Calgary, can offer to us. Basically, it's really saying that how good you are able to feel and participate in where you live, work, or play in both physical and social environments throughout the city. And so physical and social environment sounds a little complicated, but really what it is physical is all the physical environment things like community, your community, your park, recreation buildings, schools, or your workplaces. And the social environment is matched with it, where it's saying how you feel in all those places and how many connections and relationships you have in all those physical environments. So how do you feel in your school? How do you feel at work? How do you feel in community centers or parks? That's really how we want to make sure that you're able to have a good social well-being, is by having meaningful opportunities in those physical places, but also the relationships and connections for the social. So this really says, like, sometimes I like to say, like, do you feel like you belong? Do you feel welcome in all spaces or places? And even with different groups of people when you're in the city or in your community. This is really important because all these things can make your physical and mental health better. And your social well-being can be directly impacted by racism. So on the next slide. When racism still has an impact on all aspects of our lives, and social well-being is one of them. It directly impacts your social well-being because it can make you feel like you don't belong or you're not welcome. And some examples where we see social well-being being affected by racism is where we have a lack of culturally diverse or appropriate programming or public art in our communities. We have a lack of Indigenous, Black, and racialized community members representing or being employed in different frontline or decision-making positions. So do we see racialized community members like Black or Indigenous or other racialized groups as leaders in different parts of our city? We also then also see examples of our social well-being being affected when we are over-surveilling and policing Indigenous, Black, and other racialized community members at community centers, recreation facilities. So for example, you know, when you're at the basketball park or you're in parks and different places, do you see that Indigenous or Black or other racialized community members are being made uncomfortable, being unnecessarily called on or checked on by the police or staff, and just even other community members questioning why they're there or encouraging them not to be in public spaces? And this is really important. And while we're giving these examples, because when you don't feel like you belong, it can limit how much you feel, how you want to participate. And there's so many opportunities and activities in society that we're all meant to be part of. This is not only bad, though, for us as racialized people who are from Indigenous or Black communities and other groups, because it's not impacting our city by limiting our ability, but we then lose the benefit and potential greatness of all these individuals that everybody should have in our society. And so when I want you to think about this, when we're saying like, I feel good in my community, I feel like I belong, do you also see yourself represented in public art when you go around the city or in your community? Or do you see your friends or your neighbors or your family members also seen in leadership? Do you see if they're feeling comfortable in public spaces, that everybody feels like they're safe to, but also welcomed in all our spaces? And so the next slide, I'd like to explain that maybe some examples of how maybe we aren't being as welcoming to everyone. To understand that impact of this, is a great way to understand this is looking at microaggressions. So microaggressions are defined as everyday intentional or unintentional interactions or behaviors that we have that communicate bias or discrimination towards certain groups of people, like racialized people here in Calgary. These examples of communications could be comments, body language, interactions, or other behaviors that really makes a people or a group of people feel like they're less than another group, like they don't, they're not as good. Microaggressions are hard to identify because you probably, unless you experience them personally, you really don't understand how they're showing up. But in so many ways, we see microaggressions coming through in our society, where any kind of behavior that emphasizes how different you are, or usually in reference to their race or ethnicity, can project a feeling of that we shouldn't belong, or that we're not part of society, or that we are meant to be here and we're not welcome. Sometimes this comes through as questions that are maybe a little ignorant, avoiding certain people, and even sometimes backhanded compliments. While racist comments that we expect to hear in public when we hear of racism are usually very obvious, microaggressions are still a form of racism, especially targeted at race groups, but they're just a lot more subtle and sometimes difficult to recognize. You see them, or you probably hear them in everyday situations, such as your conversations or chats with friends, when you're at school talking to people, or even for adults and other people when you're at work. These subtle behaviors are often unintentional, but they do actually create some harm. And microaggressions can create such negative impact on people because it can make them feel bad about themselves, like they don't belong. And usually when you're constantly receiving or like taking on these comments or behaviors that makes you feel so different or othered, it can really start impacting you and making you feel stressed, anxious, or depressed. And so on the next slide, there's a great organization that's actually based in Calgary, but it's a national one, called the Canadian Cultural Mosaic Foundation. And they actually developed a comic book a few years ago called Race Issues, where they talked about and shared about microaggressions that different youth here in Canada have experienced. And these are real examples that youth submitted to them, and they worked with a local designer to create this comic book. So I'm not going to read all of them. I might point a couple just because they are kind of actually hurtful, but I wanted to share some examples of what microaggressions are so that you can even recognize them yourself. So on the next slide, we have a couple. And so here's two of the comic slides, and I can definitely make sure to share this link too so you can see the comic book virtually. But you see in the first one there that we have an Indigenous boy who is wearing his traditional braids, and then you hear the other child saying, "Why are you wearing braids? You're a boy." The next slide there, we see an individual, or in the next image, we see a Black community member who's sharing some experiences about being othered or making feel different. In the next slide, we have two more examples. And so in this first image there, you see a person questioning a man who's of the Muslim faith, who's praying. And we're seeing that the person who's looking at him is questioning if he should be allowed in public. And then the next image there, we see the example of a backhanded compliment. So sometimes when you hear compliments that are actually still not nice, and they're kind of aggression, like microaggressions in themselves. So referring to a stereotype about Asian women and saying, "But you're actually different." It's even though people are trying to use those examples as ways to say, "Hey, you know, you don't follow that," we're still reinforcing and sharing racist behavior when we still acknowledge some of the stereotypes that exist. And then the last slide is two more examples. It's a really great a comic book, so I really will share that. And so that you can take a look through the whole thing. But in the first image there, we see a teacher sharing and trying to pronounce a name of a student. And even though the board says, "Let's treat everyone with kindness," and that Mr. Smith, I think is his name, he publicly in front of the class shares that, "I can't pronounce your name, it's too hard. I'll just call you Jill." And that's another example of how we other and make people feel different. And the last one there, something I've even experienced, even though I'm immigrant myself, I've been here in Canada since I was a little child. It says, "Wow, you're really well spoken for an immigrant." And then underneath you can see that the girl actually was born and raised in Canada. And it's really important to know that we have immigrants from around the world, but usually racialized immigrants. So people who are brown, Black, Indigenous, are the ones that are, or sorry, indigenous people wouldn't be immigrants, but they're usually the ones that get a lot of the targeted. And I remember being, and just a quick story, I used to sit in a group where we're talking about how do we support immigrants here in Calgary. And I've been in Canada since I was 3, so I know nothing but Canada. And there was another gentleman there who's actually an immigrant from Ireland. And he was saying he just came here a year ago. And when I was in a room, the person assumed I was new and not the gentleman who happened to be white, but was an immigrant from Ireland. So we have to remember that even like this girl here who was born and raised in Canada, why is she being asked? Or why is she being made different? Because we're determining things through racism. And so the next slide here, I want us just to reflect. So what we just heard about social well-being, what are the actions that you can do to be an anti-racist safety hero? So going against racism, we would first encourage you to be reflective. What are racial stereotypes that you can think of or that you've heard? And how do you think that would make Black or Indigenous or other racialized children feel different because of these stereotypes? Something that we can't control. What's really important about being reflective is thinking about whether it's intentional or not. Any of these comments, any form of microaggressions are need to be corrected and need to be called out, because when they're not, they are still damaging and they can create long-term impacts. Because they impact how we feel, but they can also impact how we behave in our society and how confident we feel in participating fully. But also when we believe these stereotypes or these ideas of different people and different racial groups, it can have long-term consequences, because it might seem minor now, but eventually all of us are going to be people that will have power or influence in different spaces in our lives. So this could be that in the future, you might be making decisions as a teacher, a police officer, a business owner, a politician, or even a community leader. And if we don't call out some of these stereotypes and be reflective and think about the harm that some of these different racial stereotypes will bring in, we will then actually probably make decisions based on these ideas that we start to believe. And so the last thing then, and for this section that we want to encourage you to do, is be curious. Instead of being judgmental, think about how you can be curious and be inquisitive about other different cultures or different people from you. It's natural and normal to want to know more about people that you aren't aware of or different cultures, but it may want to make sure that you're just being curious and come from a place of appreciation and be mindful and reflective of not saying or saying anything negative that can actually be disrespectful and share any of these negative stereotypes. This creates harm and limits our ability to fully be part of society and our well-being. And so we want to make sure we're not doing anything that would make people feel bad and excluded. But think of ways that you can ask questions that would just lead to being like curious and wanting to learn more about different people. And so for the next slide, I think we'll go into public safety, the last section. Oh, sorry, I skipped the poll. So we have another poll. We're really good about getting you to answer some questions. So this question here is, does racism affect people today? And this is a simple yes or no answer. So Carrie will put that in the link for you to answer that question in the chat, and I'll give you guys a few moments to be able to respond.
Okay.
My dog is also enjoying the presentation. He just got up and like and looked at me. He's sitting behind me.
Okay. So everybody said yes. Who's answered thus far?
Thank you, everyone. And yes, we would agree. I think we're trying to make these questions really easy, but I think it's really important that we know that racism still is affecting us today. So moving us into the last section is public safety. So on the next slide, this is the last area of how we can support our community and well-being and how you can actually think about how to be an anti-racist safety hero. And so Jasmine will share a little more on the next slide about how some understanding of what public safety means in terms of being anti-racist.
Great, thanks, Ariam. And thanks, that was a great review of social well-being and microaggressions as well. So, like Ariam said, this is the last area that we're going to talk about today. So on the next slide, there's just a few services that we usually talk about when we talk about public safety. So thinking about the people who are keeping our communities safe, we think of police, of fire, of bylaw services. But first it's important to define what public safety means. So in general, public safety is understood as keeping people, property, wildlife, and the environment safe from natural and human-made disasters. But an important part of public safety is community safety. So community safety means feeling safe when you're out and about in Calgary, especially when talking to police officers, firefighters, emergency responders, and bylaw service officers as well. So, however, because we know that racism is a part of society and can affect our lives, we need to also be anti-racist in supporting public or community safety. So from an anti-racist perspective, so anti-racism public safety is keeping people and communities safe from racist attitudes, racist behaviors, practices, and laws. So let's, for example, take a look at the job of the Calgary Police Services. So they attend to any concerns reported by anyone in the community. It's their job to prevent and stop crime from happening and to ensure public safety. So looking at fire and emergency response, they work to protect and reduce damage to property and the environment, such as fires, natural disasters, and floods. So this includes things like the Calgary firefighters and the fire department. So what does racism have to do with the community helpers that we just described and the ones that you see on the screen here? So, well, some people have had some good experiences while others have had some not so good experiences with these community helpers. So it's important for us to talk about these not so good experiences so we can come up with solutions to the problem. So like we've been saying throughout this presentation, as a society, we still judge people based on race. So people can be judged negatively and therefore not get equal support or support from these services. So if we look at the next slide, we're going to look at another story example. And for this time, it's John. So John is 12 years old. He grew up being proud of his Indigenous background, and he's very close to his family and the community. So one day, John and his family were walking to their cars after a barbecue in the park. And then people started harassing them. One person actually came over to them and said, "I don't think this park is for people like you. Maybe try going to a park in a different part of town." So John was surprised and he looked at his uncle, waiting for him to reply. So John's uncle was a pretty tough guy, but he looked scared and didn't say anything to this man who came up to them. So John asked his uncle why he didn't say anything back to him. And John's uncle explained that sometimes saying something just makes people more upset, makes them more angry. And it's not always safe for us to stand up for ourselves in these situations. So John asked, why not call the police? His uncle said he didn't actually know if the police would make him feel any safer. So what does John's story tell us? So it's important, of course, everybody who lives in Calgary, it's important that we trust the services that are supposed to keep us safe. So whether that is police, the fire department, emergency services. So we hear stories like this that happen all the time in Calgary. Sometimes Indigenous, Black, and racialized people who have a history of discrimination from the people who are supposed to help us feel safe hesitate when reaching out when they need help. So as well, there's still work needed to make laws and efforts that can better keep everyone safe. So what happened to John's uncle and family is an example of street harassment. And I'm gonna actually pass things back to Ariam to talk a little bit about street harassment.
Yeah, thank you, Jasmine. We're almost at the end of the last section, but we thought we'd also go a little deeper into understanding what happened to John and his family, because we need to make sure that everyone in our society, every person in Calgary feels safe. And sometimes there's still gaps in our laws, in our policies, and the behaviors that we understand or the things we believe about different racial groups that limits making sure all of us are safely supported and can benefit and are supported by all these services. But street harassment is what kind of is an example of what happened to John's family. They were outside, they were in a park, and they were walking, and someone clearly discriminated against them by saying, "You don't belong here." And so street harassment actually is a systemic and cultural and intergenerational issue that is widespread here in society and even here in Calgary. It denies people who experience or the victims of it safe access to public spaces and forces them to change their behavior, usually out of fear and worries of their emotional or even their physical safety. So if they might be emotionally or physically harmed. To be clear, to harass is to communicate with a person in a way that would cause offense or humiliation in using conduct, comments, or actions that refers to a person's race, religious beliefs, their color, their disability, age, their ancestry, or even the place of origin, as well as marital status, their income level, and so many more pieces of their identity that we use to actually harass these individuals. This all impacts how you can feel, because people who are victims of street harassment sometimes begin to think that their identity is powerless, and which we saw John starting to question when he asked his uncle, who was usually so strong, why didn't we go back at them, and what made him stop from defending themselves and even saying, like, I'm proud of who I am. This is not okay, though. Harassment is never okay because we are a society. But because we are still a society that's learning to address racism and how to be anti-racist, where we take actions that stop these activities from happening or these behaviors from happening, Indigenous, Black, and other racialized community members are still experiencing harassment here in Calgary and can feel unsafe in public or different community spaces. And actually, specifically, when research the City of Calgary has been doing, found that 45% of Calgarians are still saying that they feel that street harassment still is impacting them moderately or even majorly in their life, and in making them feel that their quality of life and social well-being is even being impacted. But we are starting to work towards addressing it. The City of Calgary, like many other cities around Canada, use bylaws and policies to make sure we can address and actually create actions to stop or reprimand even people from behaving this way. But we're still looking at how we can address the bylaws, because right now the gaps are there that don't actually address racism. So on the next slide.
Okay. You okay if I take over, Ariam?
Yeah, actually, go ahead. Sorry, I'm even getting too excited about all this.
No, that's great. Thanks. Thanks for explaining street harassment. So with all of that knowledge, how can we be an anti-racist safety hero when it comes to public safety? So one of the things we talked about that is a great thing to do is to be a good ally. So when you see something is wrong, let someone know. If you see someone being treated unfairly, make sure you stand up for them. So John and his family should be proud of his culture and their heritage and not feel unsafe because of who they are. So When people say something bad about someone else based on their racial background, you should call it out or tell someone that you trust. When you do this, you're an anti-racist safety hero by making our communities feel more welcoming and safer for everyone. So with that, that's our last section. I think we have a poll, just our last poll is next. Okay, so should we talk about racism? And I think it's just a yes or no answer on the poll, but I would just encourage everyone to think about why as well. So, and then maybe Carrie can let us know about the results from this poll as well.
Absolutely. So I did have all these questions in the same link. So some folks answered it ahead of time. So we do have the answers ready. We had 43 folks say that yes, we should talk about it. And we had two that said no.
And those are good. You know, I really want us to think about this, and these are good things to think about. But as we talked about, we want to be anti-racist as a city, as people here in Calgary, because that's the only way we're going to address racism. As I said at the beginning of the presentation, we know, and many people already agree, that racism is bad, but that's not enough to actually change racism and remove it from our society, so that everybody can feel that they can be part of it, they feel good about being part of our city, and can be whatever they want and not limited by some of these behaviors or beliefs we have about different racial groups. And so even though I appreciate that we want to make sure, and I'm curious why maybe those individuals said no, whatever your comfort level is, we encourage you to be that anti-racist safety hero. And we can actually go to the last slide. It might be a good transition into reviewing everything. Today we talked about how you can be that anti-racist safety hero by taking five different actions. So the first one is naming it. As I just said, the hardest thing for us to address racism is when we don't have words or are clearly explaining what racism is and what those experiences are. So it makes it easier for racism to exist in our society when we don't name it. The next thing is raising your voice. So when you name it, what are the next things you can do to make sure that people are aware that this is an issue? Raising your voice. Then from that, we want you also to be reflective. It's still a learning for all of us on how we can make sure we are not saying negative things or limiting people by encouraging or saying racist stereotypes or really emphasizing differentness and othering of people. And so being reflective gives you the opportunity just to really consider how maybe the words and the things that we do are impacting Indigenous, racialized, and Black community members in Calgary. And next with that, be curious. It's okay to want to know about different cultures. Differences are okay. I think sometimes we think we want to make sure everybody is the same, and that's not it. It's just about how we can be respectful of learning about different cultures and different people and different people who are racialized or not. And lastly, as Jasmine shared, we encourage you to be a good ally. So how can you help stand up when situations of racism come up in school, in home, in your community? It can start as little as making sure you disagree with some of those comments or talking to a trusted safe one or an adult or even your teacher about, hey, I think we need to make sure that doesn't happen again, or that we check in on, you know, John even and his family, and how we can make sure that they can still feel good about themselves, care and love their identity, and not feel bad in a way that limits their confidence and their ability to participate in society. Because as all of us, I've been saying, we're on a journey. And I say that word very clearly because we're still learning as a city, even the city of Calgary, but as a city of Calgary, just people around and all of us here, how we can be anti-racist. So as we learn, we will learn how to make better actions that challenges racism, but also how we can make sure to make everybody feel included in that process. And so thank you so much for hearing us today. And what we want to do with the few minutes we have left is kind of go into a question and answer. So I think we can go straight to the last slide, because I'd love to introduce Lorelei, who's actually our community safety lead with the City of Calgary. Just the next slide after this is us saying good. Thank you, me and Jasmine. But Lorelei here is also part of the anti-racism program team. She can share a little more if you have questions about what we've been doing since 2020 in terms of supporting community anti-racism work here in the city, but also ask us any questions. We're excited to hear from all of you.
Well, I'll just say hi, everyone, if we wait for some questions to come in. Thanks for joining us, and great job, Ariam and Jasmine. Great job.
All right. So we do have one question that came in a bit earlier in the presentation. So I'm just going to go read that out for you, Lorelei. And ladies as well, if you want to chime in, how do you tell people they are doing micro racism? I believe maybe microaggression, micro racism, microaggressions without bullying.
That's a great question. Yeah, I'm going to look for it. And a couple of years ago, I found this really great resource. It's called the Racism Disruptor. So usually all you have to do is ask a question. Can you tell me more about that? Why do you think about that? Or I think that made even just explaining in a calm way, hey, that made me feel bad, or that's not a nice thing to say. Why did you say that? It's really about stopping the conversation and putting it back on the person to say, can you be reflective? Can you think about this? Or even just making sure they understand that what they said is harmful.
Perfect. I don't have any new questions that have come in, so I'll just give folks some time if they want to submit any other questions. Okay, we still, I think that's everything. I don't have anything new come in yet.
Well, Lorelei, I don't know if there's anything else you want to share. Even just thinking there's still work happening at the City of Calgary, especially the community stream. I could even put the link maybe or share the link with Carrie about how anybody can participate or learn more about what we're doing.
That's perfect, Ariam. That's exactly what I'd say is we need you. We can't do this alone. The journey to becoming anti-racism involves all of us. And so please get involved. Reach out to us. We definitely need more youth voices in this work. You're our future generations, and we need you to tell us what kind of future we need to help you build.
We did have somebody ask if you ladies would be willing to share if you have a story of what you've experienced that you are willing to share just to create more awareness.
There were some other examples, right, Jasmine? I'm wondering even, unless you have an example coming up, but I'm thinking of the one with the language barrier comment. An emotional taxi. Remember So maybe what I'll add, like, I don't know if it's okay to share Jasmine or Lorelei, but something I often want to bring up about for people who are Indigenous, Black, or racialized, how, I'm going to be very clear, and I know you guys are older, how sometimes tiring this is having to navigate and making sure we all still get the best resources. So sometimes in like the formal research is called the emotional tax that racialized people pay, having to do all these extra efforts to make sure they're included, or that some of the racism, even the subtle things like microaggressions, are addressed so it doesn't impact them now or even later. And so recently I came actually across a story of a young, I think she was in her 20s, she's of East Indian background, talking about her dad was asking her to like come help her with something at the police station because he had been part of a hit and run. And when his car got hit, the police officer came, and instead of listening to him thoroughly, the police officer actually said and wrote it in the report that there was a language barrier because the police officer didn't understand or care for his accent. And this was really upsetting to the dad. And the girl was actually sharing, his daughter was saying how normally she's like, I always have to help my parents a lot because people really don't try to make efforts to understand them. But her dad was actually really taken aback because he's like, I was a good driver. I did all these right things, and I was trying to explain what happened, and the officer just was ignoring me because of my accent and that I was different. And so his, not only did the tax of like feeling exhausted from the daughter, but the dad having to work with the dad and go with the dad to the police station to get that corrected is extra efforts. We're constantly doing these little things, and it's really tiring. And I have to do this all the time. Like I was saying, my family is from Eritrea, and we came as immigrants when I was a child, but my dad has like multiple degrees and all these things, but they didn't want to say his name properly. And they're like, I'll just call you George because of my last name. All these little things that kind of just make us feel different and othered, that even though I will say my dad is a very strong and social and confident person, he's just like, I'm just going to take it. Some people, it really makes them tired and makes them feel exhausted. And it's hard to to constantly have to do that. And so that's why that last one about being a good ally, that last step of how to be a good anti-racist safety hero, how can we stop and address and call these things out, make sure that people like us don't have to always do the extra work to make sure our lives and our needs are supported.
Hey, so we do have a couple more questions that have come in, if you ladies are okay with just going over by a couple minutes.
I'm going to say bye to everyone. I unfortunately have to jump off. I have a counselor waiting, so I'm going to run, but you're in very good hands and an amazing job. And I look forward to hearing from everyone.
Thanks, Lorelai.
Thanks.
Okay, so the last two questions that have come in. So we have, why is it ignored when children make racist comments?
That's a good question. I think, Ariam, I'll let you maybe start this one. We were just talking about this yesterday, but let me go ahead.
Yeah, I don't know. You know, I think we kind of give kids a lot more room because they're still like young and they maybe aren't as understanding of how to their impact on everybody. But I still agree that we need to still talk to kids, and maybe we just, how do we change the approach? We don't want to make children feel bad either too for maybe accidentally saying something or if they did intentionally. Even if you're a kid or you're an adult, being accountable to your impact and how you can, even when it doesn't have to do about racism, but every time, maybe when you cause harm on somebody else, you should be made to reflect and maybe even apologize to the people that you're offending. But I agree. I think sometimes we let kids kind of get away with it. And I think as a city and maybe even some of our organizations are still learning how to talk about or hold us accountable when it's with racism. And so I would encourage, again, like, it's about a conversation. It's making sure accountability doesn't mean we have to completely get rid of you or you're no longer able to be part of society. It's really about sitting down and making sure you understand the harm you caused and even taking that extra step and apologizing to those who you harmed if that's possible. So I would argue that we should do that with kids, because I met so many kids and my friends and my family who were bullied in school, especially for their race. My cousin even talked about growing up in the 70s in Texas, and they put gum in her hair and just constantly referred to her about how dark her skin was. And the teachers didn't do anything then because it was a different time, and they were like, they're just being kids. But it impacted her, and she's now in her 40s and she still remembers how that feels. And so we really need to make sure that let's not make it let kids get away with it, but we can still have a conversation and talk to each other to make sure we understand the impact of that. And if possible, again, apologize to the person you harmed, because we don't know how long that's living in them.
Lovely. And the last question we had come in is, how can we make a difference besides speaking up?
Sorry, I don't know if everyone can hear me because I keep freezing, so I'm missing parts of the... I would say two things with that. Like, besides, I think educating yourself is always a really good start. There's the resources Ariam shared with microaggressions. I think those are really good places to start. And just, I think, starting with education, starting with knowledge, looking at maybe kid-friendly resources around racism, making sure you understand different cultural backgrounds, different racial backgrounds, things that are okay to say, things that are not okay to say, and also getting involved. I think, we mentioned some different options of getting involved, but maybe even Ariam can, I don't know if there's any more city-specific resources you could talk about with youth participation and anti-racism programming or, anything like that about how youth can really get involved.
I would encourage, those are great answers. Learning, making sure you take some time to learn on your own about people's experiences with racism and how we can support an anti-racist society. There's a lot of fun books, a lot of resources online, but getting involved. And I like to say that everybody plays a role in making a change. So sometimes you'll see people who are very public and in front that are protesting, but you can also participate and contribute back by just getting involved with organizations that are supporting change. So whether it's the Mayor's Youth Council, they're looking at racism. I think there's other groups like Youth Central that you can volunteer for. You can see if you can volunteer for your school in some different ways, if there's groups or programs, because everything that you do that's in support of challenging it, even if it's you know, I'm really good at making like web pages or social media. You're really supporting that awareness and supporting Calgary and your even your community, whether it's your school or your neighborhood, to change and think differently. And then even slowly as we learn more about how we can be anti-racist, stop making those actions that are limiting us as racialized people. So I'm really encouraged to not think that you have to be always in front. If that's what you want to do, that's great. But everybody has a role in supporting this change.
Amazing. So that's all our questions. So I'll leave it to you ladies to close up.
Yeah, thanks everyone for those. Those are really, really great questions. It was a pleasure to be able to speak about this today and hear a little bit from all of you through the answers to the polls. And yeah, we encourage everyone to continue this work and look for ways to get involved. And yeah, thanks for having us. And I don't know if Ariam, you want to say anything else, but...
No, I think that's great. Thank you, everyone. Like, this is not very common that we get to speak about anti-racism so clearly, especially with like young people like yourself. So I really hope that you follow up on any of the links we send, but take some time to learn more on your own and how you can be that really great ally or that support that challenges what's going on and how people are feeling when it comes to racism.
Okay, lovely. Thank you, everybody. Have a good day.
Okay, thank you. Bye.